Hawkins Regional YouTube service today. These have been regional services since the coronavirus restrictions, but today would have been a combined regional service where we all come together anyway. We've got representatives from our Hopkins region congregations taking part in this service today.
And tomorrow is the 43rd anniversary, that's June 22nd, of the formation of the Uniting Church in Australia. So as we worship God, we'll reflect on God's leading of our church and of our region and God's call to unity.
And as we do, we acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we live. We pay our respects to the elders past and present and honour their custodianship of the land. We acknowledge that we benefited from their dispossession, and so we commit ourselves to reconciliation and justice as First and Second Peoples together.
Let us pray. Dear God, we're switched on to worship you and connect with you.
We're in different places, but we are united.
United in the blessing of the gift of life.
United in sharing this wonderful world of nature and diversity, beauty and power, mystery and risk.
United in the love you have for the world.
United in the spark of your spirit within us.
United in our interdependence on others throughout the world.
United in a common future we all share.
United in our human needs and desires.
United in our knowledge and lack of knowledge.
United in our need of your forgiveness. Dear God, there is so much we have in common.
Forgive us for the ways we judge each other and amplify our differences.
Guide us in wisdom to be more united in heart.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
And now we want you to help us sing our Give Glory song, where we've written some new words for the Hopkins region. Okay, let's sing together.
Take this sand, water cool, one, two, two, one and full. Give glory, glory to the Lord. Cat chewing, big fat dairy, one leg, one goo, and one fairy. Give glory, glory to the Lord. Ancient people, ancient people, share the region of his glory. Plant the seeds, living water fill our needs. Take our windmills, take our beach, whales and fish within our seas. Give glory, glory to the Lord. Elvis too, Hopkins Falls, distant swimmers, climbing walls. Give glory, glory to the Lord. Our debts out for a catch, growing in coordination, share a dip's collaboration. Fun faith, you can punch, cafe mabunga, community lunch. Give glory, glory to the Lord. Op shop got, kids club too, Port Fairy Folky, we sing to you. Give glory, glory to the Lord. In Ellensburg, yeah. Looking out beyond our patch, let our nets out for a catch. Throwing in coordination, share our gifts, collaboration. Grass, beer, pancakes, Port Lake food, sharing faith is what we do. Give glory, glory to the Lord. Aged care services heavily, we grow older verily. Give glory, glory to the Lord. Ancient people, people new, share this region, Hopkins Blue. Faith-filled hearts, plant the seeds, living water fill our needs. Take this sand, water cool, water to warn and blue. Give glory, glory to the Lord.
join me in our statement of faith. Jesus was born in Bethlehem, the son of Mary. He grew up enmeshed in the Jewish faith of his day. He was given unique insight into the reality of God. His message was the complete grace of God towards all people, loving us as we are, forgiving our failings and wrongdoing, and calling us forward into true life. He revolutionized religion based on rules and reward and punishment, with a relationship with God based on spirit and love. He spoke of the coming kingdom of God, in which the inequalities of power and privilege would be evened out. He lived all he taught with integrity and was able to love and forgive his murderers. He appeared after his death to his friends and entrusted them with his message, praying for their unity, that they love each other as he loved them. He unleashed his spirit for his message and word of love to continue within his friends and the world. This continues today, and we are a part of it. Each of us has a unique calling as individuals and as churches. May we live out this good news in all aspects of our lives. And our psalm reading today is Psalm 133. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. It is like the precious oil upon the head,
running down upon the beard,
upon the beard of Aaron,
running down on the collar of his robes.
It's like the dew of Hermon,
which falls on the mountains of Zion.
For there the Lord has commanded the blessing,
life forevermore.
Hi, Valmay. Hey, what did you think of that reading?
Oh, how did that get in the Bible? That's disgusting. What a dirty man Aaron must have been, having his hair get so oily that it ran down his beard and onto his shirt. Oh, he needs OxyPure Ultra Sheen Extra Oily Shampoo Maximum Strength. Of course, I don't need that with my glossy tresses.
I think you might have misunderstood the Bible reading there, Valmay.
No, I haven't. I've seen what places are like when brothers live together. It's not just the hair that's greasy.
Oh, hello, Kanga. Hello, Gaga. I'm Jeff. And this is Valmay.
Well, 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 isn't this an historic occasion?
You mean an hysteric occasion?
I mean, here we are together, Gaga, all in church, side by side. Finally, Gaga and Valmay get to meet. I never thought I'd see the day.
Gah, nor did I. Fancy sharing the stage with a girl and a muppet at that.
Hey, who are you calling a muppet? Big Beak? Yeah, pull your beak in. Anyhow, I'm playing right out of Jeff's right hand.
Yeah, Valmay, and he's a boy. Get the point? My point exactly.
Oh, well, look, I suppose if you're talking about that psalm, when the psalm was written, they used the word brothers to refer to all people, not just boys. And it's about how good it is when people live together in harmony. And that bit about Aaron...
Oh, if he doesn't look after his hair, he'll finish up with air off.
Yeah, you girls, you just don't get it, do you?
You just stop being so cocky, you galah.
Ah, you can talk, Miss Bigwig.
Hey, what I was trying to say was about Aaron. He was a priest. And so I think the psalm is making the point about when there is good leadership, people can live in harmony. And then there was a bit about Mount Hermon and the watering Zion. It's about just how far the blessings of people living in harmony can spread.
That's right, Jeff. And you two, you should take note of what Jeff is saying. Because this is a church where men and women are equals.
Yeah. You mean the sort of church tango where girls and green Muppets and people of all sorts of colour are given a stage and led into the country? Look, I say send them all back to where they belong!
Oh, sorry. Now, everybody, look, let's just cool it off. Before we tear each other apart, let's hey, start again. Look, sure, we've got our differences. We're all different beings, but in the bush, we've been called together to live in unity, just as Jesus prayed that we would be one.
Yes, as offensive as I find Gaga to be, Kanga, you're right. We might not agree with each other's views and we mightn't even like each other, but Jesus asked us to build bridges and to be together as part of his family. So really, you two, you're like brother and sister.
Huh? Ha! You mean we fight a lot?
Well,
yes, you do, but even if you don't fight, even if you did fight, the point is we're all part of Jesus' family. So, everybody, how are we all going to get on together?
Well, what about it, guys and girl? Rather than just ripping into each other, why don't you share a compliment? You know, say something nice. Something that builds the bridge between you rather than trying to throw a bomb. Hey, Velmo?
Yeah. All right, Gaga. That's a nice yellow crest you've got.
Okay, right. Well, Velma, I like your hair too. Especially because it's yellowish. I also, Velma, like the way you flick your hair around your face, which is something I can't do. And tell me, Velma, what sort of shampoo do you use to make your hair look so nice?
Yes, that's much better, Gaga. Look, I've just had a good idea. Maybe we'll just let you two talk without Jeff and I here. You could talk about hairstyles or other things that encourage harmony.
Come on, Kanga, that's pushing it a bit. How's about we just leave it here and we celebrate what we've done? We've just at least met each other, okay?
Okay, fine. But like, look, just remember, guys, we are all connected. And we're working in here together, hand in hand, all in this together.
Yeah. That's enough preaching, Kanga. Look, it's time we left. We let Jeff and Velma talk about shampoo. Anyway, gotta go. See you guys.
Before you go.
Yep.
Can you give us some tips on how you make your hair stand up like that?
Dustin Martin type haircut you do. You just got to shave it along the sides there and crest it up the best you can.
No, I don't think I'll bother with that.
Go Tigers!
Well, bye-bye.
Bye. I'm here for you, you're here for me. We meet in raw humility. I share my gift, you share yours too. Growing together, we make something new. You sing a tune, I strum a beat, pulsating words and tapping feet. A melody that fills the soul, a song of life that makes us whole.
Come on, in the chorus.
Collaboration brings transformation. Wherever two or more of you are gathered in his name, there's inspiration to change this nation. Creators without creator, it's bigger than you or me. I try to sing on my own, but I can't find a harmony. My one guitar just can't compare with a full string symphony.
Oh!
creators, without creator, it's bigger than you or me. So come together, join the band, sharing songs across this land, 'cause music is God's holy glue that moves us together to heal and renew.
A Bible reading today is taken from the Gospel of John, chapter 17, verses 20 to 26, and it's Jesus' prayer for his disciples. I'm not praying for just these followers. I'm also praying for everyone else who will have faith because of what my followers will say about me. I want all of them to be one with each other, just as I am one with you, and you are one with me. I also want them to be one with us. Then the people of this world will believe that you sent me. I have honoured my followers in the same way that you honoured me, in order that they may be one with each other, just as we are one. I am one with them, and you are one with me, so that they may become completely one. Then this world's people will know that you sent me. They will know that you love my followers as much as you love me. Father, I want everyone you have given me to be with me, wherever I am. Then they will see the glory that you have given me, because you loved me before the world was created. Good Father, the people of this world don't know you, but I know you, and my followers know that you sent me. I told them what you were like, and I will tell them even more. Then the love that you have for me will become part of them, and I will be one with them.
In our gospel reading, we have Jesus' prayer for his disciples. So that prayer was set just before his arrest, where he's praying for unity among the existing disciples and then amongst those who would become his followers later. A unity of love, just as he has that love between him and the Father, and so that the disciples would share that love, but also show the clarity in which Jesus showed the Father, that through their love they would show the Father as well. Today we have some members of our discipleship learning community. We've got Helen and Julie and Colleen and Robin and Carol, which are about half of the group. And we've been studying the New Testament this semester. We've learnt a lot about the different contexts for the different writings in the New Testament. And the more we can learn about who wrote them and who they wrote to and why they wrote and the situations, the more we can understand then what the scriptures might be saying to us in our situations. But one thing that we've seen is that the unity of the church, the unity of the disciples, wasn't easy to maintain. It was a struggle for the church right from early on. Somebody like to tell us something about those struggles to maintain unity right from the start?
I might start. I think the first, there were lots of little things that were sort of niggles in personalities and things, I guess, on the way. But I think the first major struggle came very early, because the earliest followers of Jesus were strictly Jewish, and they lived in Judea, in the south, of part of Israel, in Jerusalem as its capital. And in that first century, it then slowly spread as the apostles carried out their missionary activities along the Mediterranean coast, to pockets of believers throughout the Roman Empire, taking with them the letters of Paul and the Gospels. And so the Gospel of Jesus had spread. And as that happened, the communities in those places grew. And by the way that they lived and they cared for each other, they also attracted Gentiles, non-Jewish believers. And however, as welcome as the communities made them feel, there was a problem to the traditional faction, the conservatives, I suppose, of those early Jewish Christians, who insisted that not only do they accept Jesus, but they also had to obey the Jewish law and to be circumcised. Because you see, up until then, the Gentile converts hadn't been required to observe those Jewish laws and rituals, nor be circumcised, even though circumcision was a sign of the old covenant that the Jewish people had with God. Now, Paul...
wasn't something you'd really want to
I get where they're coming from. So, Paul, even as females. Now, Paul, he'd additionally been persecuting the early Jewish Christians, but he had this dramatic conversion and he received revelations from God that perhaps he wasn't going the right way. And as a result, he started a more inclusive mission to spread the gospel to the Gentiles, telling them that God's new covenant, as distinct from the old covenant, was open to everyone. So what he was saying was that having faith in Jesus as the Messiah was now all that was needed, because Jesus had come and fulfilled the old law, and they just didn't need to do those things like circumcision anymore. Peter, however, he was the leader of the community in Antioch, and he began to insist that the Gentile Christians, they and their people there too, did follow some of those Jewish laws. Well, Paul wasn't happy about this, so he arrived there and he saw that Peter wasn't being faithful to what he saw as the true gospel of Jesus, and he told them so. Now, this disunity, you can imagine, amongst these two powerful leaders and amongst their communities, led to what was known as the Jewish Council. And it was the meeting, a big meeting of the elders, a bit like assembly that we have in our church when we're making big decisions. And they had to decide what Jewish things and that the non-Jewish believers would have to take on to become members. And it was here that the council decided in favour of Paul and the Gentile Christians. And from this time onward, the Gentile Christians were not bound by most of the ceremonial regulations of the Jews. And I think that this Council of Jerusalem demonstrated really well for us the willingness of those leaders to make compromises on certain secondary issues in order to maintain that peace and unity in the church. Robin, that wasn't their only struggle though, was it? Would you like to tell us more?
They did have lots of struggles. And I want to talk about the Jewish Christians a bit more too. They, after Jesus' death, there were really troubled times between the Jews and the Romans, which ultimately ended in the destruction of the temple in 70 AD. And the Jews were forced out of the city. I think they actually, were they starved out, Jeff? I think the Romans went around the wall and wouldn't let them out, and they had no food and no water, and they were starved out. So it was really, really a terrible time. So it must have been mayhem, wasn't it, at the time? So being a Jew was difficult at that time. I can only imagine what it was like to be a Christian. The Christians I'm talking about this morning are the Jewish Christians. They were no longer allowed in the synagogues, their previous place of worship, Jews confronting Jews. These Jewish Christians were being ostracized from their historical beliefs and their faith. At the same time, the Romans, who were worshipping other gods, which Jews were exempt from actually, which is interesting, but the Jewish Christians were not exempt. You can only imagine what that would be like. I reckon it would be like being a Geelong supporter and having to go to the MCG in Barrack for Richmond, possibly.
But it was terrible.
Wouldn't be much. But anyway, sorry, Malcolm, if Malcolm's listening. So Matthew's gospel, that gospel was written for those Jewish Christians who were kicked out of the synagogues, told to worship Roman gods, and they would have had so many Jewish friends against them, angry with them, I would imagine. Mm. I have read it somewhere that Matthew is a gospel born in the pain of rejection. Mm-hmm. So he had a lot of work to do to bring Jesus' message to these people. He targeted the Pharisees. His motto was, Jesus came to fulfill the law. And those early Christians wanted to relate to Jesus to their Old Testament beliefs. So Matthew was saying that they could do this. Now John's gospel, which was written after Matthew, was also trying to connect the Old Testament to Jesus. He begins with, in the beginning. So that definitely connects it, doesn't it? And of course, John's reading we've listened to this morning was Jesus praying for all believers in the world to be one, united in God's love, a love that was in Jesus, and a love that we have in us. So that's a little bit about the Jewish Christians that I've talked about this morning with you.
One thing that happened also was that while they were, because they were in such terror, I suppose, of being attacked, they actually then tried to fit into the community. And while women within the church originally had leadership roles, they very quickly became relegated to become secondary.
Yes.
And so it's a very interesting thing that while Jesus would have had women as equal people within with his followers, they then became secondary people. Yeah. And that has continued through the centuries of the assumption that women can't take leadership roles within the church and aren't allowed to speak in church. Thankfully, in some churches, this has changed recently, but it has, that's been a major issue. Yeah.
We saw too in the letters of John, where there was some divergence of beliefs as well too. Does anyone want to say anything about that caused conflict?
Yeah. Yes, John, in the letters, it was very interesting. I'd never read those letters before. But they spoke about, at one stage, how people had to be excluded because they weren't believing that Christ had come in a human form, and in another, that they had to extend hospitality to people who came in their name. And it was also interesting reading about Paul and his letters to Corinth.
You loved Paul, didn't you, Alan?
You came to love Paul.
You understand him a little bit better. Because I've struggled to read Paul over the years, but he was talking about, and he talked about the need for inclusion again. Originally, the rich would eat well at communion and the poor would have very little. And he wrote that wasn't in the spirit of communion. And he also involved the notion of the body of Christ and that all members have different gifts and different talents.
So it was a way of holding the unity because, everybody's different, but everybody has a role.
And I think that diversity, appreciating that diversity is really a key thing, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, we hear in the Bible, we want you to all have the same mind, have the mind of Christ, but within that, still to have diversity of gifts. And
I think that diversity, it's not just tolerance, it's not tolerating that other person, it's actually understanding them. And not necessarily accepting their side, but, coming to some sort of terms of, not agreeing perhaps so much as accepting that they are different, they're thinking differently to you.
I guess it's like it was way back at the beginning, where they concentrated on what was really important, love of God, the gospel message, which was very inclusive, and it was the love that came from the Father to the Son. And to us.
Yes.
Yeah.
And we've struggled in our church with some issues, really big issues. Mm. And I think we've done it really, really well. I think the Synod have done it well with the consensus, the way they come to agreement with consensus. Mm. It's acknowledging what the majority is saying and saying, yes, we agree with that.
There's not a lot of pain involved in that sometimes.
Yeah, and there is a lot, it can be a lot.
It's like a birthing process, isn't it? It's been right through the church and the development.
Yes.
It's been quite painful, but
We've got there.
We have got there. And God's given us permission to get there.
Yes. Mm-hmm. It's with
because
His Spirit.
God's in us now, so we're making those decisions. Yeah.
So there was like a groundswell of ecumenism in the 20th century that led to the formation of the Uniting Church in 1977. But it seems that it's not got much further. So, you know, we call it Uniting Church because it was an ongoing process, and there's been sort of cooperating churches, but we haven't got much further. And been thinking with the coronavirus too, the ecumenical stuff just seems to have vanished. As everybody's just trying to survive. It's the struggle for unity to answer Jesus' prayer still goes on. Carol,
we might not have all the other denominations, you know, coming in to join with us, like the original three that formed the Uniting Church. But when I think about the Uniting Church of Australia, it's very diverse culturally now. So I think that's something that has grown, and that has also made it a little more complicated in determining issues sometimes, because you've got people with very different cultural backgrounds whose thinking isn't the same as people from other groups, and you have to listen respectfully and work through all that. And yeah, I'm not sure that we are really siloing ourselves at the moment. I think there's a lot happening in terms of understanding what's a common experience through the pandemic as well, and what's really to be valued.
And decisions that have been made have been made to include varying opinions. So same-sex marriage, I suppose, would be one of them
It was huge, I can tell you.
A huge decision. Yeah. But it wasn't that everyone had to do it. It was a matter of people being able to make a choice. A yes or a no, we're not ready to do that. So, yeah.
So just a last question. Are there things that you've learned from your studies that think would guide us in how we are to be church amongst the churches these days?
Love.
It comes back to that, doesn't it? And I think we've all really enjoyed John and a new appreciation for John's writings, that the Gospels of love, and he was the writer of love, that becomes the most important thing, that love for one another.
Even those that we have strong differences with.
And there's also the social justice element. Now with Paul collecting for the poor in Jerusalem from those early days and asking the other churches to contribute to that. And so there's a model there, I guess, for us going out and helping
sharing
various ways in our communities.
And James saying it's not just what we say, but it's what we actually do that's important as well.
And even in the writings that seem more harsh, there is an underlying love. In the Ten Commandments, there is love.
And that love is not an emotional love. It's all powerful. It's different. Julie and I spoke about it before, and it's just amazing how many times did they write in the Bible about love, you know? And it is God's love. And I think people out there, even not coming to church, are recognising love as being the truth in everything, for everything.
You notice that?
Yes.
Through the pandemic, where things are up on Facebook and things like that, it's about loving yourself and loving others and caring. Make sure you pick up the phone and make contact with each other. There's that real emphasis on that, which, the Spirit of God moves in extraordinary ways and doesn't necessarily need the churchy words or the structures to be moving amongst the people. I think that we've seen that and we experienced that. And that is exciting.
Fantastic. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Good on you.
Thanks, Jim.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are one. We are one in the world, and we pray.
And we bring to God now our offering prayer. Let us pray. God of all time and place and peoples, we come here today rejoicing in our unity with you and with one another in Jesus Christ. We offer ourselves, all we are and all we have, to live in love, commitment and care for this world you created and love. Accept our giving and bless and empower us with your Spirit to live the gospel in all that we say and do. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray the prayer for the people. Dear God, we give you thanks for 43 years of the Uniting Church in Australia. We thank you for the rich traditions from which we have come and our heritage as churches.
We thank you for those who had the vision to grow this Uniting Church that would witness to the power of your reconciling love for all.
We give thanks for what our church means to us and means to you. We pray for the congregations of our region, our Presbytery of Western Victoria, our Synod, and our nation.
We pray for our President of Assembly, Deirdre Palmer, and our Moderator of the Synod, Denise Leach. Bless Sharon Hollis, who is also to be our next President of Assembly.
We pray for our Presbytery Ministers, Trevor Bassett and Andrew Phillips, our Chairperson Andrew Boatman, and other office holders.
Guide and lead us in these uncertain times for the Church. Help us to hear and respond to the Jesus Prayer for unity and for our particular call to us, economical in this region.
In this Refugee Week, we pray for all refugees and asylum seekers worldwide, and especially those under the care of our country. We pray for the end to the conditions of war, terrorism, persecution and famine that force people to become refugees.
May your Spirit move in all people and lead us to act with compassion and seek true peace and justice.
We pray for other worldwide issues, the coronavirus, climate change, poverty, corruption, violence. We add our prayers to those of the suffering, and while we feel overwhelmed, we continue to pray and offer ourselves to serve and campaign for your way in the world.
We pray for ourselves and those of our community. In quiet, we name our concerns for those who are sick, those facing the end of life, the bereaved, the unemployed, the lonely, the struggling and fearful.
And we join our prayers together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thanks everyone for being part of our Hopkins Region service today, and thank you to all the helpers that we've had as part of this service. And we finish with this blessing. May we see what unites all of us ahead of what divides us. May we be agents of God's reconciliation in bridging those divides. May we look forward to the culture of God that's on its way towards us from the future, and caught up in the great spirit of love, live it now with a caring but reckless hope. In the name of Christ.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity may come.